Most Americans know President H.W. Bush as our 41st president, serving only one term in the White House. But his former chief of staff, Jean Becker, says his actions after leaving the Oval Office were equally remarkable and are chronicled in her new book, The Man I Knew, The Amazing Story of George H.W. Bush's Post-Presidency.
President Bush was very sad when he lost his re-election bid in 1992, but they didn't hate getting back to normal life either, and they found it to be a great adventure.
From the time he left the White House until his death in 2018, the University of Missouri journalism graduate and former USA Today reporter spent nearly 25 years as his chief of staff.
Talk about being able to name drop the life that you've lived with by being at his side and her side, Mrs. Bush as well, is extraordinary.
It doesn't seem real anymore. I grew up on a farm in Missouri, and my graduating high school class had 57 kids in it. And again, I say in the book, Mikhail Gorbachev once got so mad at me, he told me to shut up. But I was kissed by Tom Selleck.
Hey, so, life is good.
Becker got her entry into the Bush's lives when she served as a deputy press secretary to First Lady Barbara Bush. And she says she intentionally steered away from politics, nor is her book a tell-all.
I wasn't sure these were my stories to tell. And then I thought, well, they are my stories. If not me, who? He really stayed off TV and out of the press. He really felt, and he writes about this, you had your chance. You had your chance. And now it's time for you to get off the stage and accept when it was, again, to promote a good cause or to support someone he loved. He didn't seek any public opportunities at all. And what's interesting is, you know what? The man was brilliant. History is treating him very kindly. I'm very excited.
Becker shares many funny and poignant stories of trying to control the life of an active former president.
I knew that America respected him, but I felt like they really didn't know him. They didn't know how funny he was, how dear he was. He lived life with passion, with joy, with purpose. And I just wanted them to know this amazing man who walked into my life one day. And it's just been a lot of fun.
Jean Becker, welcome, and welcome to St. Louis, and thank you for joining us.
It is so exciting to, I'm in Houston, but my heart and soul is in St. Louis. I was just there a couple of weeks ago. So anyway, it's really thrilled to join you all today.
Yes. Well, we're sorry we missed you. And of course, the book is The Man I Knew. And several times in the book, you talk about being in St. Louis, you refer to your Missouri roots, but I searched and searched and never found out exactly where, which community, which, can you share that with us?
Yes, I grew up in, well, my dad was a farmer, so I grew up on a farm in Audrain County. The closest town was Martinsburg, Missouri. And this is, it's about 2 hours west of St. Louis.
Okay, I was searching and searching, and boy, that was a mystery throughout. I thought, okay, wow, she's got a Missouri connection. I want to thank you for representing St. Louis and actually the Cardinal fans so well. And I'm going to go a little bit about you. When you attended an Astros game, and I thought, good for you, Jean Becker. Do you remember what you wrote about that game? It was like low attendance.
President Bush went to his grave feeling that one of his biggest failures, Victoria, was not turning me into an Astros fan. But as all St. Louis Cardinal fans know, if you grew up a Cardinal fan, you're a Cardinal fan for life. And so I went to a lot of games with him, but I think the game you're talking about, President Bush was frustrated. Attendance at the Astros was very low. He was good friends with the owner, Drayton McLean. This was where the Astros were really good. And President Bush bought like 50 to 60 tickets. He invited the Secret Service and their family, the staff and their family, other random people. And he bought the tickets way, way up in left field, the upper deck of left field. And the stadium was empty except for us. And oddly, a children's choir from Uganda. You can't make this up. So at some point during the game, these cute kids from Uganda, I think it's Uganda, started singing to him. They figured out that the former president of the United States was sitting right over there. So they started singing to him. And you could tell that the stadium was sort of, well, the Zoom cam found us, the scoreboard camera. And here comes Drayton McLean, the owner of the Astros, charging up the steps to say, President Bush usually sat with him, to basically say to him, what are you doing up here? What's going on? Who are these people who are singing? All that time, Victoria, I'm obsessed, standing behind Drayton, Lou Brock, my childhood hero. It turns out, was in town for a Hall of Fame meeting, and I'm just staring at Lou Brock. I'm thinking, oh my God. And this is, you know, for a woman who prides herself on being professional and calm. And I mean, Mikhail Gorbachev once told me to shut up, but I'm a wreck in front of Lou. So I just blurt out, I love you, Lou Brock.
Right. And then Jim Nance is there, the CBS sportscaster, and he kind of puts you to the test to say, oh, yeah, right. You really are a true fan. Right. And what does he ask you?
He said, so, Jean Becker, if you're such a Lou Brock fan, what number did he wear as a Cardinal? Oh, come on. Number 20.
Right. So thank you for showing him that you are a true Cardinal fan. Yes. And it goes even deeper than that. Actually, one of your few disagreements that you write about is about Albert Pujols.
One of the biggest mistakes I ever made, President Bush, he was very good friends with Ted Williams. They were personal friends, and he was a huge fan. So I had just read this big article about Albert Pujols, that if he stayed healthy, that he could end up being the best hitter who ever played the game. He was on track to break almost every record there is. And I'm at Minute Maid Park here in Houston with President Bush. Albert hits this towering home run. And as he's trotting around the bases, I tap President Bush on the shoulder and I said, sir, we could be watching the best player to ever play the game. This could be historic. And I told him about the article I read. And he said, seriously, you think he's better than Ted Williams? Really, Gene? Has Albert Pujols hit 403 in one season? He said, well, how can you think that? And you know what, Victoria? For a long time after that, random people would come up to me and say, did you really tell President Bush that Albert Pujols was better than Ted Williams? He's really mad about it. One of the people who said that to me was former Secretary of State James A. Baker III. They'd been playing golf. And I ran into Secretary Baker and he said, what were you thinking to tell President Bush that Albert Pujols, you would have thought that I'd said to him, you know, I think Saddam Hussein was a pretty good guy.
Right, right. Oh, it was a great story. And I love it because of its kind of innocence. I mean, who would think of all the things and all the people you met around the world, both of you together, truly, as we're going to talk about in a moment, that was the one thing that kind of just got him, right?
And
just
biggest fight we ever had.
Yes. Well, I'm going to do one more Missouri connection and then go into the background a little bit more. Another one, a little later on in the book, is two things. His relationship with Johnny Morris, who, for those who don't know, is the founder of Bass Pro Shops out of Springfield, Missouri, and of course around the country, but they were big fishing buddies. And it's one of the probably the little known stories that he tells to you, that Johnny Morris tells to you in the book, regarding how the former President Bush cheated death once again.
Oh, I'm so glad you brought up Johnny Morris. I just saw him. My family went to Branson on vacation a couple weeks ago. And Johnny, of course, lives in Springfield and Branson. And we had dinner with him. And he just is the world's best guy. I just love him to pieces. But the story from him in the book is they used to go fishing in the Canadian wilderness every single summer. And one summer, they would camp out. And one summer, President Bush around the campfire, and President Bush went into the woods, as Johnny discreetly puts it, to do his business. And he doesn't come back, and he doesn't come back. So finally, the Secret Service had not gone with him because, you know, let's give the guy some privacy. Well, they found him up to his neck in a bog. He had fallen into a bog, into quicksand, and had, it was already up to his neck. And Johnny said what was so amazing, his arms were spread out, which is the right thing to do. And he said President Bush was very calm. And he said, well, it's about time you guys came looking for me. And, you know, I don't know how much longer it would have been before he just disappeared. Yeah. And, you know, President Bush loved to keep count of how many times he almost died, right, which was sort of what a thing to keep count of.
Well, and I guess, and it started when he was 19 or 20 during World War II and getting shot down over Japan, an island in Japan. Exactly. And you talk about that at length because he revisits it later in his, really his senior years. We just told our audience that you were chief of staff for President Bush, his post-presidency, for nearly 25 years. He liked being referred to as 41, and you described that story. He didn't mind that, did he?
Loved it. You know, it was a big problem when his son became president, because suddenly there were two President George Bushes. And there were a couple times, including on Inauguration Day, when the new president asked his dad to join him in the Oval Office, and White House Chief of Staff Andy Card was in the Oval Office at work. And he said, President Bush, and they both turned around. And my boss, 41, said, he knew that's when he had a problem. So a wonderful congressman, Congressman Dingell from Michigan, came up with a solution at a speech in DC at the Alfalfa Club. He announced he had a solution. 41, because President Bush, George H.W. Bush, was the 41st president of the United States. And 43, he was the 43rd president of the United States. And so he loved being called 41.
He sure did. You know, I actually laughed out loud several places in the book, and I was about some teary spots too, but I did. And I the phone conversations were a hoot. And you said you could devote a whole nother book to just the phone calls. Individually or together, George and Barbara Bush were funny people, no matter what, either way, but as a couple, they certainly were. You show some, and sometimes unwittingly, I love the Sam's Club story. They would do very natural things that you just don't expect, you know, someone of that stature to do. They just were as everyday as they could be, were they not?
They were, you know, for two people who had lived so much of their life in the public eye, in many ways, they're just like the rest of us. And President Bush was very sad when he lost his reelection bid in 1992. But they didn't hate getting back to normal life either. And they found it to be a great adventure. And as you mentioned, Victoria, one of their big discoveries was they love Sam's Club. But as anyone who has shopped at Sam's Club knows, I don't, because I'm single and I live by myself. You go to Sam's Club to buy stuff in bulk. And I went with them a couple of times, and they would get their flatbed cart and go around the store. Somewhere in Houston, there is still a big thing of Cheetos. They bought more Cheetos than any two people I ever met. But the price was right, so they went to Sam's Club.
Well, if any place they would need it, I would think of it being Kennebunkport, because you spent a lot of the time, because your office was there during the summers at their main home. And man, that was like a resort, people coming and going with all the grandchildren. I mean, heads of state. It was like a who's who of around the world that would stay at this, I'm sure, large but modest home.
You know what? It was a modest home. It was large, but it was your typical sort of seaside cottage, big. I remember this story is not in the book because this predates me, but when President Bush was president, he invited Francois Mitterrand, the president of France, to come meet with him at Walker's Point. And there's a famous story about the French advance team doing a walkthrough. They were going to put him in what was then President Bush's mother's cottage on Walker's Point. And the advance team was just appalled because, you know, I think, not to offend any French listeners, I think they're just a little fancier than we are. But the French team said, this is not acceptable for the president of France to sleep in this house. But, you know, they President Bush offered everybody a bed. It sometimes drove his wife crazy.
Yeah. I don't know how she did it. I just reading it exhausted me, to be honest, but we'll get into the exhaustion part here in a moment. I want to go back to when you talk about becoming a chief of staff, and really it was, quote, a temporary position. You worked for his wife, Mrs. Bush, and wrote a book about her. Or you wrote it about her or with her? Which would you describe?
She wrote, oh my gosh, she will smite me from the grave if I don't tell you. Both of the Bushes were great writers. Mrs. Bush wrote her memoirs herself, but I was her researcher, her fact checker, her editor. She would write a chapter, and then it was my job to read it. It could be interesting at times. It was my job to say, this doesn't make any sense. I have no idea what you're talking about. Anyway, so I went to Houston. I worked for her at the White House. I was one of her deputy press secretaries. I go to Houston to help her with her memoirs. When her memoirs are done, I was going to go back into journalism. I had a job opportunity at the Chicago Sun-Times. One of my last editors at USA Today was at the Chicago Sun-Times and was going to hire me. I was very excited. I didn't want to live in Chicago Cub territory, but I was excited about living in Chicago otherwise. But anyway, President Bush asked me if I would stay, Victoria, just for a couple months. His chief of staff retired. And he said, just keep the seat warm. Just help me. I says, I need help. We need help. And it was very small staff. I told him, I don't know how to be a chief of staff. I've never been anybody's boss, budget. I've never been in charge of anything. And he said, that's okay. We'll figure this out together. We never talked about it again. We just got busy.
25 years later. But you say in the book too, as you're working with Mrs. Bush, that you really got to know him in the kitchen because he'd come down for coffee or a snack or whatever. And that kind of built your relationship, correct?
Absolutely. They had to put me at a card table in the kitchen. There wasn't room for me in the new office of George Bush. And so they set up a card table in his tiny kitchen. You know, life is just interesting, isn't it? Yes. That's how we got to know each other. He would come in and make a cup of coffee, and he would come get a glass of milk, and we just started visiting, and we got to know each other.
It's fascinating. And I was kind of surprised, or maybe naive, about the amount of, I thought, well, what kind of work could they possibly do? But you were absolutely swamped. So explain to some of those, because we don't want to tell too much about the book, but the whole behind the scenes thing, if anyone out there watching it or hearing is interested, this is the kind of book you want to read, because it's fascinating. All the minute things that you wouldn't think would happen after somebody is, quote, retired from the presidency, but there is.
You know, just the mail was overwhelming. And thankfully, we had a wonderful director of correspondence named Linda Pepsel, but he was getting hundreds of pieces of mail a day. And we had this whole system set up, and, you know, Eagle Scout letters and military retirement letters and people who wanted a letter on the anniversary of this or that, or wish my mom 100th happy birthday. That's one whole segment of the office. He traveled a lot. Some of it was paid speeches, and that we outsourced outside of the office. But he and Mrs. Bush, their philanthropic work was huge. Right. And they both had some big causes they believed in. Cancer was one of the big ones. That were very active in cancer. They actually founded a national cancer group called Sea Change. He was very active with his Points of Light Foundation, which he founded while he was president. She, of course, was active in literacy. And just keeping up with their philanthropy was almost a full-time job alone without all the other logistics of his life. And then you enter his friendship with one William Jefferson Clinton. And actually the 43rd president was the matchmaker when that huge tsunami hit South Asia on Christmas Day, 2004. President George W. Bush asked his dad and President Clinton if they would help raise money in the private sector. All the big nonprofits were headed to South Asia, Red Cross, Doctors Without Borders, Catholic Charities, but they needed big, big support because this was a huge fiasco. And both of them said, of course, and through that project, Victoria, they became best friends. Yep. And at any time there was a disaster of any kind, Hurricane Katrina, Hurricane Ike, Hurricane Harvey, actually all the former presidents came together. I was thinking about them and I thought, oh my gosh, if President Bush was still alive, they would be in Haiti right now.
Yep.
But I hate to admit this, it's going to make me sound like a terrible person, but every time there was a big disaster, I would think, oh no.
Yeah.
Oh no, there goes life as I know it. But it was wonderful.
And we, you talk about the odd couple, President Clinton and 41 in the book. And then even the younger Bush, 43, would say we're brothers from another mother.
Yeah.
It was that kind of relationship. And you mentioned the younger Bush with President Obama. So there's something to be said for these. It made me kind of wistfully wish for those days. Seeing that right now. So that's all I'm going to say about the current state of affairs. But I kind of yearned for that. That made me wistful when I read about their relationship. And then when President Bush passed away, just your relationship with the Clintons as well. And all four of you, including Chelsea, hugging and crying in the aisle there.
You know, if you had told me election night, 1992, that the day at his funeral, I would be burst into tears. When I saw President Clinton, I just started crying. We just sort of dissolved in each other's arms. And it was a special friendship. And one of the things, Victoria, about the friendship, it did occur to me as I was writing this book. It's, as you said, the book is a lot of fun. And thank you for saying that. There's just so many fun stories. But as I was writing it, I thought, you know what? President Bush really did live as a blueprint on how to live a life well lived.
Yes.
And one of his great strengths that I learned from him, he knew how to find the good in everybody. And he and Bill Clinton, they were political, I don't want to say enemies, but political, on the opposite side, the political rivals. Thank you. That's a word, perfect word. They were political rivals. They didn't agree on much politically, but they found in each other they both had a servant's heart. And I do think Mrs. Bush is right. She is convinced that in her husband, Bill Clinton found the father he never had. But what a great lesson for all of us that they could put aside their disagreements and they raise hundreds of millions of dollars for people in disaster relief situations. What a valuable friendship for all of us that was.
It certainly was. And you talk about it eloquently in the book. One thing I did dig through, and I found this in my husband's library. He had this book that the president wrote called All the Best, and it's his life and letters. And it made me, when I was reading your book, I thought, you know, I remember his book that he wrote about letter writing, which is probably, frankly, a fading or dying art, which is kind of a shame because it is a tangible history that he gave us a great gift. So having said that, his letters, the book, he wrote a lot of his thoughts down either in notes to others and emails that you share. How did this help you with the writing process?
It saved my life, you know, because for one thing, I wrote the book during the pandemic and his presidential library was closed almost the entire time I was writing the book. So I thought I'd be doing a lot of research and pulling a lot of files, but I wasn't able to do. But one of the smart things I had done sort of randomly and without really thinking about it is anytime I saw an email or letter he wrote that I thought was special, I made a copy of it and I kept it. I kept a file. And he would kill me for telling you this. He hated the word legacy. He felt he didn't want anyone to talk about his legacy. He called it the L word. But the secret file of my desk was called legacy. And I had no idea what I was going to do with that file. And the other thing I did is I used to, as you know, because you read the book, I used to email my sisters a lot.
Yes.
And say, you're not going to believe what happened today. And
those are very entertaining and from the heart. And it's almost it's almost a diary of yours. It really is.
It ended up being my diary. And I'm so glad I kept them. And I would put them in a file because I didn't know then I was going to write a book. But the book almost wrote itself because I had this wonderful paper trail of emails and notes and memos. And President Bush was a great writer. Oh my gosh, he could have had a whole second calling as an author.
Well, one of the chapters is, and I laugh because you mentioned it quite a bit, I have an idea. So there's a whole chapter to I have an idea. A favorite exclamation from the president, like he'd walk in the room in the morning, and your reaction usually was either, I guess, hold your breath, cringe. I'm not sure which one came out first, but whether it be his leadership forums or let's see, what else did you mention? Okay, well, the skydiving or speed golf making, usually it was some kind of, it could be as small as that or something as grandiose as, let's do X, Y, Z. And next thing you know, you're planning something grandiose.
Like going back to Chichi Jima, where he was shot down.
Yes.
Probably the biggest idea that he hit me with. And I remember it was January 2nd. And the reason I remember that is because it was the first day back after the holidays. And I just so remember I had sort of planned out my day. I was going to just sort of dig out. We needed to take down the office Christmas tree. Just sort of, you know, slowly but surely start the new year, but not obsess about, you know, getting off to a fast start. Just sort of wade through the day. And then he shows up. He used to get to the office at 7 o'clock in the morning, and he had 4 pots of coffee. He drank a lot of coffee in the morning, read 4 newspapers. He says, "Gene, I have an idea." And on this particular day, he says, "Gene, I have an idea. I've been thinking about this for a while. I want to go back to Chichi Jima, where he was shot down." And you need to read the book, like you have read the book, but to all you wonderful listeners and viewers out there, let me just say one thing. It's a great story, but to get from Houston, Texas to Chichi Jima in the South Pacific, it's not easy. It's a volcanic island. There's no airport. And that's all I'm going to say. You got to read the book.
Right. Okay. Yes, I agree. I don't want to give out too much. And frankly, that was one of my hardest things to do, was like, oh, tell me about this story, but let's save it for those who can pick up the book. Another thing I want to talk about is random acts of kindness. And this is where I would get kind of teary eyed. Like, it just shows his humility.
He had a big heart. And I said earlier, he had a servant's heart. And the best example in the book, I mean, he would do a lot of little things. I mean, one of the most random things is he gave his driver's license to some guy in Oman.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that one. That's a good one.
Who gives a total stranger their driver's license? And when I questioned President Bush about it, he said, well, he just wanted to have something to remember me by. And the only thing I could think of was to give him my driver's license. I'm like, what? I mean, it was just the most random things.
I know.
Story that went viral about a random act of kindness is when he shaved his head.
Oh, yeah. Yes.
3-year-old son of a Secret Service agent had leukemia, and he lost all his hair. He was bald because of chemo. And so his dad, to make his son feel better, decided to shave his head, to say to his son, being bald isn't so bad. Well, then President Bush's entire Secret Service detail shaved their heads in support of their colleague whose son had very serious leukemia. As you can imagine, Victoria, this really struck at the Bush's heart. Sure. Because they lost a 3-year-old daughter, Robin, to leukemia in the 1950s. I learned so much from President Bush. And one of them definitely was think big. You have nothing to lose. Yeah. And a lot of us hesitate to roll the dice. You know, you might have this idea, but you're too nervous to pick up the phone. You're too nervous to ask that person out or to take that new job. And President Bush's point was always, you're going to win some and you're going to lose some. But unless you try, you're not going to win any.
So you mentioned thinking big. That was one of the life's lessons you took from both George and Barbara Bush. Is there anything else you'd like to share with our listeners and viewers?
Yes, the other thing, and I learned this from my mom and dad as well, but I learned it in spades from both President and Mrs. Bush. You got to give back. You've got to figure out a way to get involved in your community and in your country. And it doesn't mean, Mrs. Bush had a favorite quote. I think it came from Mother Teresa, where she used to love to say, everybody wants to save the world, but nobody wants to do the dishes. Mm-hmm. And her point was, you don't have to be Bill Gates. You don't have to be George and Barbara Bush. Just find out, what does your neighbor need? What does your community center need? Does a little boy down the street know how to read? find your passion and find a way to make a difference and get involved. And I've learned that from the Bushes. I'm still on the Points of Light board, for which I'm very grateful, because they're doing great work and encouraging America to volunteer. And you know what? America does have a big heart. America has a big heart. And it's, you know, but if you don't, if you're not involved in something, find out how you can make a difference.
The book is called The Man I Knew, the amazing story of George H.W. Bush's post-presidency, from Jean Becker, his chief of staff for nearly 25 years, and Missouri's own, we might add. So Jean, thank you so much for joining us, and continued success. And now that you are you considering yourself retired?
Well, before I answer that question, I would just love to thank you all so much, the St. Louis County Library. Wow. I thank you for giving me this chance, first of all, to talk to the people back in Missouri, and just for an opportunity to talk about President Bush. It's so much fun to talk about him and to tell these stories. So thank you so much. And retired, I have in 2022, I need to figure out what I want to be when I grow up. That's on my 2022 list. I'm not sure.
I got it. Meantime, we're going to have everyone head over to Left Bank Books in St. Louis to pick up this latest tome that you've written, The Man I Knew. It's a great read. Thank you so much, Jean. It's been such a pleasure chatting with you.
So much fun. Thank you, Victoria. I've loved our interview. I feel like I was chatting with a friend.
Wonderful.
Thank you.